Hello, welcome back. So in the previous two parts, we have discussed about the bending stresses theory of simple bending. And there we have derived the bending equation. So here in this part, we will discuss about the shear force in the beam member. So we have seen that in the non-uniform bending, beam is subjected to shear force also. While in case of pure bending, beam is subjected to constant bending moment only. So, well, in case when the beam is subjected to shear force and as well as bending moment, so in that case, it becomes very important to find out the stresses associated with the shear force. So here, the shear stresses are basically of two types. One is the transverse shear stress, and the second one is the longitudinal shear stresses. Now, which one is the transverse shear stress? That we will try to understand with the help of this diagram. In this case, there is a part of beam, and this is basically the cross section of the beam. So when the force is acting on the beam, because of this force, shear force is also generated, and shear force per unit area, per unit cross sectional area is known as shear stress. So when shear stress is along the cross section like this, so on all the cross section, shear stress will be along the cross section like this. So these are the transverse shear stress. Now in this beam, you can see there is an element Mn, and this Mn element is subjected to the downward arrow, which are actually depicting the transverse shear stress. Now, because these arrows are downward, the other side of the element here, it will be upward to balance the equilibrium, for the equilibrium condition. If on this face, if shear force or shear stress is showing with the downward arrow, then on the other side, it will be showing with the upward arrow to have the equilibrium condition. And we also know that in the previous lecture, I have discussed the complementary properties of the shear stress. So when these two faces are subjected to downward and upward shear stress, the other two faces, this one and the lower one, these will also be subjected to the shear stress. So those shear stress arrow will be something like this. So you can see these arrows are along the length of the beam. So these are also the shear stress, but they will be known as longitudinal shear stress. And these longitudinal shear stress are generated because of the complementary property of the shear stress. So here I have discussed, due to the complementary properties of the shear, this stress will also create the corresponding longitudinal shear stress that acts along the length of the beam. And if we separate this element, you can see here, this element, this is the downward force. On this face, we will have the upward shear stress. Similarly, on this face, this is created because of the complementary property. And on the lower face, it will be something like this. And this is depicted by the shear stress condition in this element here. So these two stresses in this case are basically the longitudinal stress, and these stresses are the transverse, which are along the cross section. So this is how we can visualize this shear stress generated because of the shear force in this beam section. Now we can understand this shear stress property with the help of an example. For example, if we have a wooden planks, if we have three wooden planks which are placed one above each other, so if these planks are not bonded at this point where they are placed, if they are not bonded together, then what will happen? When the load will come on them, then they will try to compress, but because there is no bonding in between them, then they will simply slide on each other, and therefore you see this kind of profile because of no bonding. Now, if we bond these three planks together, if we have strong bond in between this section, then what will happen? Then it will actually behave like a pure beam. And in this case, the element, the upper plank will try to compress, as it is evident in the figure. And while the lower plank, it will try to stretch. It will try to stretch. And this sliding, because upper layer is trying to compress and lower layer is trying to stretch, this difference in the sliding, they will actually generate the stress at the bonding point where they are bonded together. There will be a huge stress in the layer, and that layer, that stress is basically because of this longitudinal shear stress. So that is the classic example of this longitudinal and transverse shear stress. So this is basically the example of longitudinal shear stress, in which the sliding is happening or is about to happen because of the presence of longitudinal shear stress. Now, like we have the bending equation as per theory of simple bending, we also have shear formula with which we can find out the shear stress at any point in the cross section of the beam. So I am showing you this formula directly, and we are not deriving this formula because it is not in our scope. So here I am directly showing you the formula. So this tau is basically the stress, and we can calculate this with these four terms. So in this, V is called the shear force. So shear force can be calculated easily by method of section or equilibrium condition, like we have done in the structural mechanics course. And Q, okay, before Q, first we will understand what is I. I is the moment of inertia, and B is the width of beam. And Q is the moment of cross-sectional area above the point where we are required to find out the shear stress. So we will try to understand this Q in more detail with the help of diagram. So basically, this above formula, this is the formula which we generally use to determine the shear stress. And with the help of this formula, we can actually find out what will be the maximum stress, maximum shear stress generated in the beam. So at any point in the cross section, we can easily calculate the shear stress with the help of this formula. Now here, T is the shear stress in the member at the point located at a distance y from the neutral axis. Well, for example, this is the beam cross section and this is the neutral axis. So above neutral axis, generally there will be compression, and in below the neutral axis, there will be tension. Now, if we have to find out shear stress at this point, then we can find out this. So if at this point we are finding, then first we will try to measure what is the distance from the neutral axis of this point where we are required to find out the shear stress. Now, generally, when we are required to find out shear stress at this point, so generally at line joining at this point, at the whole width point, this point, we generally assume that at the whole width, the shear stress will be same at this point or at any this point. So basically, when we are required to find out stress at this line, which is y distance from the neutral axis, we can find out that with the help of this formula. Now in this, what is V? V is the shear force determined from the method of sections or the equations of equilibrium, like we have done in the previous course. So here, I is the moment of inertia of the entire cross-section area calculated above the neutral axis. So here, we will now try to understand what is Q. Q is the moment of the cross-sectional area that is above or below the point where shear stress is to be determined. Now we will understand this Q with the help of diagram. Now see this diagram. This is a rectangular beam with a width b, and for example, if we have to find out shear stress at this line. Now this line is at a distance y dash from the neutral axis. Now in this case, if we have to find out shear stress at this line, then we are required to find out Q. Now what is Q? Q is the moment of cross-sectional area that is above or below the point where shear stress is to be determined. So here, because we are above the neutral axis, so here we will consider the area above the line. So we have to find out shear stress at this point. So area above this point will be this one. So moment of this area. So moment of this area will be area multiplied by perpendicular distance, and this distance will actually be the distance between CG of this area and the neutral axis. So here the area will be a dash. Say we are considering this area as a dash, and the centroid of this area will be this one. So the distance from this centroid to the neutral axis, it will be, we are assuming that this is y bar dash. So ultimately the Q will be a dash into y bar dash. So this is how we calculate the Q value to calculate the shear stress in this case. Similarly, if we have to find out shear stress at this point, so at this point, because this is below neutral axis, so we will consider area below this line. So you can see below this line there is no area, so therefore Q value will be zero, and therefore shear force at the lowermost fiber will be zero. Similarly, shear stress at this point, if we want to find out shear stress at this point, then the area above this line is zero, so therefore shear stress at this point will be zero. And the shear stress variation you can see in this second diagram. Here it is zero, and at the neutral axis it is maximum, and at the lower point it is zero, and the variation is parabolic. So here the Q value is a bar y max. Similarly, if we want to find out shear stress at the neutral axis, at this neutral axis, then the area above or below the neutral axis will be same, which is b into h by 2, and the centroid will be at this point, and this distance will be h by 4. This distance will be h by 4. So this is how we can calculate this one. Here it will be h by 4. It should be h by 4. So this is how we calculate the Q value. Well, I will show you some more example to calculate the Q value. For example, if we have this T section, and if we have to find out shear stress at point P, at this point, then Q in this case will be the area above it. Area above it will be this rectangular one, and we are representing this area as a dash, and multiplied by the distance between the centroid of this area and the neutral axis. So that distance is y dash. So ultimately Q becomes y dash into a dash. Similarly, if we have a rectangular cross section, and if we have to find out shear stress at point P, so in that case also we will see the area above point P, which is a dash, which means this area. So this area is a dash, and the centroid of this area is where the diagonal will meet. So that is the distance, I mean that is the centroid, and distance of this centroid to the neutral axis will be y dash. So that becomes the Q for this case. Similarly, if we have another area, for example, if we have to find out shear stress at this neutral axis point, at this neutral axis point, because P is located at this neutral axis point. So if we want to find out shear stress at this point, then the area above this neutral axis will be this one, and this one. So in this case, the Q value will be a dash 2 multiplied by the distance. The CG of this area A2 is at this point, and distance is y dash 2. Similarly, the CG of this area will be at y1 distance from the neutral axis, and the same here also will follow. So this area and this area is identical and at the same distance. So therefore, this will be written like this: 2 into y1 into a1, because there are two area which are identical and at the same distance from the neutral axis, and the q value of this area will be a2 multiplied by y2. So this is how we can calculate the q value for different cross sectional area depending on the point where we are required to find out the shear stress. So that is all about the shear force in the member. So we will continue our discussion in the next part. Thank you.